And they talk about what is an arm's length pricing also. I mean, in fact, when I used to raise this issue, some of the companies used to ask, when they make an adjustment for arm's length pricing from a transfer pricing angle, would that imply that arm's length pricing was incorrect for accounts? This used to be an issue which has come up recently. The answer is not necessarily, because from an accounting point of view, when I evaluate arm's length pricing, then that is more in terms of what would be the comparable market price based on the available information for that particular purpose, taking into account the financial statement as a whole. Because I am not governed by maybe a CUP method or a resale price method or a profit split method, nothing of that sort. There could be one arm's length pricing from an accounting and auditing angle, another arm's length pricing from a transfer pricing angle. So as far as this thing is concerned, as of now, the auditing standards, whatever has been notified by the institute, that would be applicable because till such time NFRA comes up with its own auditing standard. So whatever is the procedure that we perform normally, that would apply for this arm's length pricing also.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yes. So, subsidiary company or associate company opened the balance sheet, financial statements, and recast it. In such cases, the holding company or parent company also required to publish the revised financial statements?
It's a good question. Probably, I think at a standalone level, I mean, obviously, when you look at restatement, you are not going to look at a restatement for each and every error. You will be restating only when you believe it's going to have a significant impact on the numbers, right? So let's say at an associate level or a subsidiary level, if it is significant, then you will do the restatement there, comply with all procedures. But when it comes to parent, it's not an automatic thing like, no, I have restated associate, so I have to restate parent. No, it's not that way. What is material for an associate may be immaterial for me as a parent, because that could be not even 2%, 3%. So it's not a straight yes. You have to evaluate and see if it is material, then you have to restate. If not, you won't.
Yeah. Okay.
You have something?
Just to supplement, Mr. Sriraman, see, there are two provisions under the new Act, Section 130 and 131, which needs to be understood very carefully. We cannot simply use the word revised statement and recasting. We have to be carefully use the word when we deal with the sections. Section 130 talks about reopening of books and recasting financial statement. Section 131 talks about revising the financial statements. The basic difference between two is the first one under Section 130, when the government authorities they come across or they doubt, they suspect some fraud would have taken place in the frame of the accounts, they can approach the National Comptroller Board Tribunal and get the order to reopen the accounts and recast the statement. That means the figures can be changed, will be changed in the process. In under Section 131, the figures cannot be changed. It says only the revision of the financial statement. It doesn't give the power to reopen the accounts as long as we are touching the provision of Section 131. The question which you asked that when a company is revising statement, so that you have to first decide whether you are trying to falling under Section 130 to reopen the accounts and revise the statement or to only revise the financial statement under Section 131, which can we cannot touch the figures, we can only touch the form and the manner how it should be provided. We can't change the figure under Section 131. The 130 gives authority to the government authorities. 131 gives the power to the board of directors. So the question which you raised, presuming that it is falling under 130, that reopening of accounts and recasting, if the subsidiary company is done, there is no statutory compulsion unless the authority which is approaching the National Comptroller Board requesting or praying the order to reopen the accounts of the holding company also to give effect of the changes made in the subsidiary company. Unless there is a suitable order from National Comptroller Tribunal, then the holding accounts company cannot be by automatically can be should be reopened or recast.
Second question.
I believe you are touching the provision of Section 131, which talks about voluntary revision. where I explained this under section 130, where the government authorities approach the company law board in case they suspect a fraud. The element of fraud is necessary to fall under the provision of section 131 to reopen the accounts, whereas the element of fraud is not required for the board to decide revise the statement without reopening the accounts, which the board does not have power under section 131, where it is a voluntary. Under section 131, board is not having a power to reopen the books of accounts. They have power only to revise the financial statement only in the manner of presentation.
Sir, to add to Dhanapal, very clear, in 130, we need an order based on either income tax department. First time they have brought income tax department as a part of the Companies Act. They say, no, you have not made provision for the tax liability, so I want you to revise your financial statement. Then we can go into the books of accounts and maybe change the provision entry. The books of accounts can be changed. But in 131, what I understand is the books of existing books of accounts cannot be touched. We can only pass an OSB outside the book entry to that, where we can revise, recast the financial statement. Maybe in the process the P&L account also gets revised. The profit gets up or profit comes down in the process. The existing books of accounts cannot be touched, because the word books of accounts is not used in section 131. 130 only uses the word books of accounts. So that's the lesson or the cue government has got from Satyam episode. Satyam episode, they have not touched books of accounts. They have not gone into the books of accounts. And that's the recommendation of the auditors appointed by the new board. The new board, when they appointed the new auditors to help them to revive Satyam, they said whatever is the finding, wherever there is a necessity to change, please recommend. We'll give the mechanism to do it. Where provision which was made, overshoot of provision, they reversed by an OSB entry. Outside the book entry, they passed an additional entry and they nullified. They nullified many of the boosted impacts and they brought it to the normalcy, which is true and fair representation. So existing books of accounts is not touched. That's the lesson, corporate lessons, the learnings of Satyam. So 131 is 100% reflection of Satyam episode.
Is there any penalty if found guilty after recasting that?
No, not necessarily. Let's say if the mens rea is not proven, the act itself recognizes voluntary restatement, because the statutory mandatory is separate. That would obviously will have its own penal provisions and other things. But when it is voluntary restatement, just because you are restating the account, somebody is going to come and say, why did you make the mistake? Because fundamentally, this is the concept. We are recognizing that yes, errors could happen under normal circumstances when there is no mens rea, that is culpability. If you are doing something intentionally, that takes a different path. But if nothing is intentional and if there is no mens rea, then you can't be penalized for saying, no, I made a mistake, please allow me to correct.
No, to add, supplement the speaker, actually we have been taught in our student days, and also we are practicing, whatever happened has happened. And we have a new standard called AS5, which says prior period item. So in current year, we go by that standard and we pass an entry for prior period item. Maybe after this new episode 130 and 131, there need not be a necessity for a prior period item. We can go back. Now, to supplement the madam's question, we can go back to past 3 years. For example, if I go and recast my first year accounts, then naturally there will be an impact on the second year also. There will be an impact on the immediate previous year. Necessarily, I have to recast and revise the past 3 year accounts if I am touching the 3 years back accounts. And ultimately, I am coming back to whom? The owners. And who are the owners? The shareholders. And shareholders, they will come scold the board of directors. Ultimately, they will say this has happened because they will take some water and they will say sprinkle it, everything is okay, pass a resolution, pass the accounts. So that means marappom mannippom, that power and authority is given to shareholders. So once the board comes with if you read the first line of section 131, it's so blunt and open. If the board prefers to revise the financial statement, that is how the sentence opens. There is no minimum, at least in the material fraud, our speaker was mentioning, there should be a repetitive fraud, or there should be 2% of the profits or turnover. There is no such element. If the board comes with some shareholder can rake up an issue, no, you need to change these accounts. One director, one independent director can come and say this particular entry has to be changed. Actually, only two words I can give for 130 and 131. Government should not have brought these two sections. It is Pandora's box. But of course, I am seeing from one side. The other side is, it is a hell a lot of professional opportunity for company secretaries, for chartered accountants, auditors, everyone. So much of work is there. You will definitely see lot of boards coming in future. Ividam financial statement revise seidhu tharapadum. New breed of professionals will come. They will not sign the first hand financial statement. Adala mudinjittu vaappa anga thagara irundhana sollu adhu na panni tharen adukku fees separate sir. He charged only 2 lakhs sir. Revised financial statement fees will be 5 times of what he charged, because there is no provision under the section as well as under the rule. Definitely yes, misused. That is why I use the two word, it's Pandora box. They should not have done. We have never in our student days, if at all there is a question, even teacher, if they ask, accounts has been passed by shareholders and after that something has been found and can the shareholder change, but out of syllabus question idella kekka matanga. That's what been taught to us, but now it is syllabus question.
To supplement Mr. Gopalakrishna Raju, he has deliberated the positive side of all those things which you are discussing. To put it in a negative side, in one line, the question which raised Mr. Madhavan, company secretary, to answer in a nutshell, whether it is a revision of accounts, reopening accounts, or whatever the violation under the new provisions of the Companies Act 2013, we have to remember two important provisions. One is 448 and another is 449, which is equivalent to provision of section 628, 629 of present Companies Act. 447 of present Act 2013 defines what is fraud, and 448 says imprisonment of 10 years for any misstatement in any return, any report, any certificate by any person. So we can't keep a board like how Mr. Gopalakrishna Raju says, as long as
no,
if it is the statute,
sorry to interpret, the original audit was signed by Mr. A. I will only sign the revised financial statement.
If the revised financial statements also false and found violation of provision under section 448.
Oh, revised financial statement also. No, you cannot say third time you cannot revise, no? Yeah, only second time.
We are going to deliberate more on these aspects about 1 hour and make you to scare. So today you can enjoy, tomorrow there is a separate session to scare about all this.
Excuse me.
Mike, please.
Excuse me, I have a question.
Yes.
Here.
Yes, sir.
See, I have a question on the depreciation. See, as per the new law, we can depreciate only to the extent of 95%. So on the assumption that we can realize the salvage value as 5%. But in the case of some of the assets like electronic devices and also the computers and laptops, so is it possible to realize 5% at the end of the useful life of the assets? So in that case, how to deal with this?
See, the 5% is a rebuttable presumption where the act presumes that this is going to be recovered. But there is also another thing which you have to keep in mind, that realizable value which you are talking about 5%, there is another accounting standard, revenue recognition, where you believe this money is not going to come, there is an uncertainty, then you can very well actually deal with that through that route. That's why in fact you will see many companies, they do accelerated depreciation. If they believe that realizable value is not going to be 5%, I do my normal depreciation by using 95%. Then when I maybe in between, or probably let's say after reaching 95%, if I'm not sure that 5% value I'm going to recover, you can accelerate the depreciation.
Now to add to the what the speaker said, in Schedule 2, there are two informations. One is the useful life of